Hello, everyone. Excuse me, I just lost my voice a little bit there. Hello, everyone. This is Data Driven Formula One. And as usual, Patrick Hansen, Ganapa Grebna here. Hi, Patrick. And we're talking about Lorenzo Bandini. So if you watched the 1966 season, that's the guy we talked a lot about. And today we will talk about him in depth.
Exactly, he was maybe a little bit similar to Graf Berge von Tripsa, a real local hero, which had the talent, but unfortunately first died too early, and second never had the chance to really win the championship, even if they had been close to do so.
Yeah, so that's him. And as you can see, he lived a very short life. And I have to say that in preparation for this, it was very difficult to find his pictures. I found
some very nice ones.
I found just a handful of pictures. It was very difficult to find his portraits. So normally, the majority of pictures that you will find of him are in a car. Even here, you can see like this is a pretty good shot of him. If you're watching us on YouTube, it's a pretty good shot of him quite close. But still, this is like him getting off the plane. And there are some people in the background who are also quite close. So yeah, mostly it's, mostly you will see Lorenzo Bandini driving a Ferrari car, and that's how it is. And in the majority of pictures, that's how he is captured.
Well, I think he was also a more introvert character.
Well, I think it's a combination, right? Because the introversion, but also the fact that he had a very short life very short life in sport for the reasons that we're going to basically convey in today's episode. But effectively there is not, if he had a career like Sterling Moss or Graham Hill, of course you would have had many pictures, but unfortunately his life was short, and his life in Formula One was short as well.
Exactly, and as you described, most of his photos had been him sitting in the car. On the right, you see a photo which I took at the Museo Ferrari in Maranello. And interesting to me, they have one room where they have their championship cars. And here they had the car from the successful 1964 season. And quite interesting, if you look at it, it's the number 8 car. So it was the car driven by Lorenzo Bandini and not the one which was driven by John Surtees. I don't know, and maybe I'm a little bit over interpreting it. As we know, especially if you have listened to our 1966 season, John Surtees left Ferrari. He quit from Ferrari after decision of the team that he wasn't to start at Le Mans. So they didn't left in friendship, to say it that way. And I don't know if this triggered the company's decision not to show the Surtees car of the 64 season, but the one from the number 2 driver, which was Lorenzo Bandini at that time.
Well, I mean, I think it probably also has to do with the fact that you previously talked about, Patrick, that Ferrari tended to sort of rework their cars. Some of them do not exist anymore. So in a sense, and we know that 1966 in particular was a very difficult year. So maybe also, there were some financial reasons why one car survived in the end.
That's correct, but let's say they could have easily changed the numbers from the 8 maybe to the 7, or which number John Surtees said. I mean, nobody would have recognized that. But they left the 8, which was known as the number for Lorenzo Bandini.
Yes, indeed. So, but I mean, let's all have a look at his maybe brief overview of his of his profile. And as you can see, he basically was born in Bars, drove for Scuderia Centro Sud and Scuderia Ferrari. And he died in 1967. As you probably guessed, it was a racing accident that he died. In fact, he died during 1967 Monaco Grand Prix. Mm-hmm. And we even have a picture from that race.
Mm-hmm.
So just a few minutes before his death.
Exactly. Interesting fun fact. He was Italian, but not born on the Italian mainland, but in Libya, which had been an Italian colony in 1935. We had one other Italian / US driver who also had been born in an Italian colony, not on the Italian mainland, which should become quite famous later, which was Mario Andretti, of course. So just this as a fun fact.
Yes, so he was indeed born in Libya, which at the time was Italian colony in 1935, just before the Second World War. And his father passed away when he was a teenager. Basically, he was 15 when that happened. And for that reason, Lorenzo Bandini ended up in a workshop working as a mechanic, and he was working there from a very, very young age. So effectively, at 15, he became the person responsible for the family. And he had to earn money. And for that reason, he learned a lot about cars and, was spending all his time, obviously, in the garage.
Exactly. And just to add, his father was not only just passed away, he was killed in the war. So also a violent death.
Sorry. Yeah, of course. Yeah. You're absolutely right. He was basically killed in combat. We can say that. This was quite tragically a very standard situation back in the day. I can tell you that my grandfather had very similar biography because his dad was killed in war when he was 16, and he had to, my grandfather also had to provide for the entire family, and he had a large family with I think seven siblings, so it was quite a standard story for war children of war.
Exactly, and maybe you may conclude this is one of the reasons why, let's say, fans and society accepted that each year so many young men died in motorsports, as it was quite normal, as the family still had remembered World War II, World War I, where it was unfortunately normal that people got killed. You may argue that today in 2020, society would not accept a sport where each year 2-3 people would die, statistically.
That's right. In terms of career, we've already discussed the several drivers who started in motorcycling, and Lorenzo Bandini was not an exception in that sense. So he also started with motorcycles, and eventually he managed to borrow a Fiat car for racing. Obviously through his work in this workshop.
I think it was the car by his boss, Mr. Freddy.
Exactly. And, because he was quite good at this, he had a very good, he had quite a remarkable driving talent. He was spotted by by Fiat, and you know, essentially they started to promote his talent, which is why eventually he ended up in Scuderia and then in Ferrari yep. team. Yeah.
Yep. And just to add, Mr. Gagliardo Freddi not only gave him his Fiat, but also later his daughter. He married Margarita Freddi in 1963. So he seemed to be a very down-to-earth person. He young entered in this workshop, worked his way up there. Started to have a good relation with his manager, the owner, and also stay together with his daughter.
Yeah, so, but I was just gonna say that probably not necessarily in that order, you know, Kaka and then daughter, but daughter probably had some say in this as well.
I hope so, yeah.
So, indeed, so he married Margarita. Yeah. In 1963, and also actually, you know, there are some pictures that you can find of the couple, even though there are not many photos that you can find generally, but you know, you can see that definitely two very happy people in these pictures. So I think it was kind of for Freddy, it was he was like a son, I guess. So that's part of the family. And, so the fact that, you know, Lorenzo Bandini spent so much time working in the workshop actually helped him to make these connections and eventually, helped his career in motorsport. For better or worse, because considering his early death, we don't know how, you know, his life could have gone had he not spent that much time with cars.
Yeah. Now we are in 96, and at that time we had also something like a junior program. As we discussed in our episode about 1968, we had Giancarlo Baghetti driving a Ferrari as practically sponsored, not directly by Ferrari, but by some Italian organizations as part of a development program. At that time, it was between Baghetti and Bandini. And Bandini not got the seat. That's why he decided to start with the Scuderia Centro Sud at that time. Another topic which we not touched in our episodes, it's a little bit related to Formula One. We had a quite interesting series, and we will come to this a little bit later in our today's episode, where mostly old Formula One cars had been adapted. And there had been races in New Zealand and in Australia. So a lot of the teams and also a lot of the well-known drivers used the winter time to get some additional experience and of course additional income to drive in this Tasman series. Same was also done by Lorenzo Bandini. I'm not found information which cars he drove there in New Zealand and Australia. Maybe it was something like that one. You see here an older Ferrari model. It had originally a six-cylinder engine, but to make it competitive for the Tasman series, the Ferrari team entered the 12-cylinder engine, which they had been used, for example, for the famous Testarossa. So this kind of cars had been active, and here also young Lorenzo was driving.
Yeah, that's right. And, kind of going back to 1961, this was when he drove his first world championship race in a Spa. Didn't go well for him because it was a mechanical failure and he had to retire. Yeah. But nevertheless, this was the year when he had his debut in Formula One racing, in World Championship racing.
If you are just watching us now on YouTube, you see a photo. So this is the mentioned Ferrari from 1964, the car with the number 8, the car which is now in the Ferrari Museum. At least if you consider that the car in the museum is an original car and not a replica, as some of these cars not exist in originals anymore.
Yeah, that's right. So, yeah. Well, hopefully it is there. Yeah. So what you see is the real thing. Yeah, so we actually talked a lot about the participation of Ferrari in Le Mans. in general and Lorenzo Bandini was quite successful there. I mean, he basically won Le Mans in 1964. And so this was sort of another point for him to kind of be recognized better by the Ferrari team. And he was basically at that time racing, did some of these occasional races for Scuderia Centrosud. But after this win, he was already properly spotted, you can say that, by Ferrari team.
Yeah. That's correct. And as we discussed various times, at 1960s, 1950s is what's still quite normal, that drivers not only drove the single seaters in like Formula One, but also had been active in the endurance races like Le Mans, but also in the traditional races like Mille Miglia or the Targa Florio. So they have been quite util. They have not have been just specialized on one type of car, but had been fast also on other kind of cars. And this has been valid, I think, for most of the drivers at that time.
Right. Okay, yes. So 1964, which was a very good season for him, right? And that was the first. So he won the Austrian Grand Prix. And in fact, the previous picture that you saw, that we just showed you, was actually taken in Austria in a Ferrari car. Yeah, and effectively, Bandini, he was running second in the season. He was. He also supported. I think we do not know, but we can guess that this were team orders when he let his teammate John Surtees bypass him in Mexico in 1964. And that was when we discussed 1964, if you haven't seen that episode, do go back and see it. And there we explained that it was very, very tight season. It was basically a three-way tie between Jim Clark, Graham Hill, and John Surtees. And in the end, because John Surtees won that Mexican Grand Prix, he actually won the whole championship. And in that sense, the fact that Lorenzo Bandini was supporting his teammate played a very important role in that particular season. And largely due to this collaboration, John Surtees was able to score this 9 points for the first place. Yeah,
good teamwork here by Bandini, who helped John Surtees. Of course, he himself couldn't win the championship, but nevertheless, a good teamwork by Bandini here. A Again, we are leaving Formula One in 1965. Bandini also participated again in the in Sicily at the Targa Florio. And here we have a very nice city where we see really these Ferrari prototypes driving through the medieval streets. Quite fascinating race event. For the case you have Amazon Prime, there's one documentary about the Targa Florio, which is quite interesting to see the spirit, the atmosphere of these races.
Yeah, so we discussed a lot these street races before. So we talked about them and we were saying that, oh, you know, they were not very safe. And for that reason, you know, we actually had many of such events canceled in previous years. And I quite like, again, if you're watching us on YouTube, you can see the picture that we have and how exactly the audience was separated from the cast. It was just basically some so almost non-existent barriers in a sense, so it was still very dangerous for the audience. Yes. When we went to these street races and you know, so highly dangerous, and this is why we had quite a few incidents where members of the public were hurt during such street racing.
Yeah, and 1966, as you hopefully have listened to our 1966 episode, John Surtees left Ferrari after just two races, and Bandini was promoted to be the number one driver. He didn't deliver that positive results, but we have to see that he was a little bit unlucky. Well, he was a lot unlucky because he was leading the French and the US Grand Prix and then had to retire due to technical problems. Furthermore, Ferrari couldn't participate at two of the races because we had the strikes of the metal workers in Italy, and due to this, Ferrari lost two opportunities to participate in the championship. And we will come back to this a little bit later when we play around with the numbers, when we ask ourselves what could have happened if he wouldn't have had the technical problems. Also in the 66, Bandini was pretty much involved into the movie project Grand Prix, a US production to show Formula One. He was there, on one side he was he was doubling one of the actors, so he had been inside the car if the fictive Italian driver was to see in the race scenes in the movie, and also he was like a consultant. And one thing he did in the 1966 Monaco Grand Prix, he counseled the film crew where at which part of the track they would have the accident which should happen in that movie. It's a little bit tragic to say it that way, because it was pretty much the same part of the Monaco Grand Prix where Bandini really would die already 1 year later in the 67 Grand Prix.
That's right. And also he won the 1000 Monza, 1000 yes. Kilometer Monza, and the 24-hour Daytona races. So again, so I think, you know, we can say that he was very good in these endurance races, probably not as lucky with the car, I guess, in Formula One. But, you know, when he had to drive kind of long distance, it was very efficient and won very consistently in this long races.
Exactly. And due to his success in Formula One and even more in the endurance races, and maybe also based on his character, he was very much liked and loved by the Italian fans. And so many would consider him as one of the best Italian drivers, and many think that he should have won the 1966 season. So I prepared here some numbers, similar as we did in our episode with Graf Berger von Trips. On the top, you see the real results. Important, you see here the points. So the first, the winner got 9 points, the second one, 6 points, then the third, 4 points, then 3-1. And also relevant for the championship have been only used the 5 best results of the year. This also due to the fact that the technology was not that reliable. So we see that Jack Brabham won with a total of 42 points. This is his sixth best result. The fourth place in Belgium had been taken away, as he already had 5 results which have been much better, which has been 4 victories in France, UK, Netherlands and Germany, and the second place in Mexico. Then the second metrics showed the numbers. If Lorenzo Bandini would have won the 2 races where he was leading and had to leave because of technical problems. So here we just say that he would have won the French Grand Prix and also the US Grand Prix where he had been leading. If this would have been the situation, and we have to be completely clear, it is playing around with numbers, because there could have been completely other results if you change one variable, the same as the famous butterfly effect. As we have the butterfly in China and in the US, the weather is changing. So also we would have had these effects, of course. So let's say if Bandini would have won these 2 Grand Prix instead of having the 2 times 0 points, we would assume, as there had been no result decisions after the US Grand Prix, that Ferrari would have traveled to Mexico, to the Mexican Grand Prix. And also, if Bandini would have won the Mexican Grand Prix, then he would have had the same score as Jack Brabham, and we would have had a tie, and in this case, both would have been champion. I not included it in the metrics. Let's say we could also change the scenario and be in a parallel scenario where we had not had the strikes in Italy. And you may say that also Lorenzo Bandini could have made points in the UK, for example, where he not participated due to the strike, and then he could have won alone the championship. But of course, these are quite
big assumptions. Big assumptions.
Big assumptions, correct. And as you see, even if he had won France and the US, which is of course quite questionable, then he only would have had a tie with Jack Brabham. So I think we can say that Jack Brabham together with the Brabham car was really the strongest combination. So highly speculative to say what have happened if the Ferrari would have been more reliable, but of course always interesting. And of course, I mean, this makes Formula One interesting also to speculate a little bit what could have happened if he had won that race, or what could have happened if one driver not left the team but stayed, or not stayed but left to another team. So always the interesting question, what could have happened, and if there had been more luck, or if people had decided in different ways.
Yes, exactly. So, I mean, but I guess the point is that, yeah, it's possible that he could have won, he could have had a tie with Jack Brabham. Yeah. But we wouldn't know.
we don't know.
For a fact, yeah, that's right.
Yeah, I mean, he had the talent, obviously, but it's always the combination of driver, machine. Then you have other factors as
experience. Strikes.
Experience, or you have just the strike that you are not even able to go to the race.
Yeah, so we've already kind of touched on this about the Grand Prix. Yeah, he was kind of the main consultant for the movie, right?
Exactly. And again, interesting coincidence that really he advised that this is the, let's say, this is the best part of the track to have an accident. Maybe it's the most dangerous one. And then to see that really he would die exactly on this scene. In combination, as we will see with the quotes, he was similar to Alberto Ascari, also quite superstitious. And he believed in destiny.
Yeah, so, and yeah, it's kind of coming back to the same sort of point that sometimes, you know, when people concentrate on something that could have a psychological effect on them. So if he was really thinking about that particular crash scene could have affected his consciousness.
Exactly.
When he was doing it. Yeah.
Yeah. So maybe this really affected him while he drove this chicane, because what happened is in the 82nd lap that he lost the control over his car, and maybe because he wasn't that concentrated anymore, because he had this idea already back in his mind. So he lost control and crashed. And the tragic part here is that he survived the accident itself, but unfortunately the car hit straw bales, which together with the fuel and the hot engine started to burn. And so he got injuries that 70% of his skin had been burned. And this was the reason why he died 3 days later in the hospital.
That's right. I mean, you already mentioned that he was this local hero, and there was a huge crowd at his funeral. So, right, that was basically like a celebrity, despite the fact that we cannot find many pictures, as we told you. I mean, people knew this guy. I mean, yeah, so it's like 100,000 people came to the funeral, which is impressive. So effectively he was much loved by Ferrari fans, and the fact that he was Italian, you know, Italian driver for the team also contributed to this. And generally he was basically highly accomplished endurance driver, even though in Formula One it wasn't, you know, he didn't have as much success. So in that sense, you know, he was a local hero, and this death came as a shock to many, yes, many people in Italy.
Yes, and let's say as consequence from the accident, of course, it was investigated to see if really the marshals got him out in the time that they should be. But in the relevant consequences that after this they not used straw bales anymore in Formula One, because the risk is too high that they start in fire due to fuel, due to the heat of the cars and the engine. Unfortunately, something which organizers found out due to this accident only.
Yeah, that's right. And I also wanted to say that, you know, he is buried in Milan, mm-hmm, in Lambrate Cemetery. So, yeah. So if you are into sort of finding, like I know in France, there is this tradition that, you know, you go and look for for people's graves, you can actually find his grave in Milano if you if you were there and you really want to see to see it. So yeah, and it was a huge deal for many people. It was a very big funeral, and because like we said, he was really a local hero, and he was known by many people.
Yeah. So let's see which cars and teams he used while being in Formula One. First season, 1961, with a Cooper Maserati T53, used by the Scuderia Centro Sud. Then, luckily, next year he switched to the Scuderia, driving the Ferrari 156. Next year, he started with the Scuderia Centro Sud, and due to his positive results, got a seat at the Scuderia Ferrari again, where he continued also in the next 2 years, which included that he drove the last races in the US and Mexico, officially driving for the North America Racing Team. If you not did so yet, we have a special episode about this particular US Ferrari team. Then 66, continuing with Ferrari until unfortunately his tragic death in 67.
Yeah, that's right. And I mean, practically his career was in Ferrari, we can say, practically exclusively in Ferrari, with one small deviation to Cooper. And as we explained before, he was he started in motorbike racing and then was actually racing in this borrowed Fiat. And this is how he got his got his chance to race for Ferrari, and kind of once he got this chance, he kind of was loyal to the team.
Yes, and maybe this is also one of the reasons why he was so much beloved by the people.
Yes, that's right. Yeah, that's one series. Yeah, that's also a very interesting episode.
Yes, it's a topic which we not touched, and I thought to use the opportunity to speak about this interesting series, as the cast had been very similar to Formula One, and due to this, a very good opportunity for teams, but also for drivers to spend the winter time driving in New Zealand and in in Australia. It started in 1960 as a series of independent races in Australia and in New Zealand. And then in 64, they combined these races to a real series, which have been active until 1975. So it was active for 11 years. The name comes from the sea, which divides New Zealand and Australia. So the races traditionally started in January to late February or even March. So the time where it is still too cold in Europe and in Northern America. So really a good opportunity, especially as we didn't had races on the South American continent anymore. At least in the beginning and the middle of the 1960s. Even if we may not remember that series today, there had been a lot of very well-known teams and drivers active. Not surprisingly, Bruce McLaren being at home and had the opportunity to drive, but also we had winning drivers as Jim Clark and Jackie Stewart. We had Chris Amon, which we also see here on the photo, driving a modified Ferrari. I'm not sure if I mentioned it in that episode. He was driving practically a Ferrari, but it was labeled as Dino, which had been as a daughter company of Ferrari, which specialized on the smaller cars, normally using six-cylinder engine. And in this case, you see here, they are using the Ferrari car, but with the small six-cylinder Dino engine. And for marketing reasons, they're not called it Ferrari, but the Dino 246, even if it was, of course, based on the Ferrari 246, which was driven in the Formula One season.
Mm-hmm. Looking at this, at the table, if you're watching us on YouTube, you can see that Asmon Sirius. Well, I definitely remember reading a lot about Chevrolet, and they had great success in this series in '70s. Right. And that's kind of what you see on the screen now. And of course, previously in the 60s, you can see it was Lotus. Mostly Lotus, and then it was kind of mostly Chevrolet in different combinations, either as a contributor or as a standalone company.
Yeah, I mean, it makes sense as the US manufacturers had been more present on the Australian continent than the European ones.
Yes, absolutely. The movie Grand Prix.
Yes, we still have it on our to-do list to finally see it. As mentioned in earlier episodes, quite interesting that Hollywood decided to do a movie on Formula One and maybe not on NASCAR or the IndyCar series, which have been much more popular at that time. But so I guess it was a mixture between international lifestyle and fast cars, something similar as the highly popular James Bond movies at that time.
Yes, that's right. And there were a large number of well-known drivers in the film.
Exactly.
It was a very successful film, and probably, you know, just when we ask the question why American movie industry decided to do it, is of course because they understood that they probably would be able to sell it not only to Indianapolis fans and the US Grand Prix fans, but also to a European audience. And in fact, they made the right decision because the film was financially was a great success.
Exactly, and it included a lot of very famous Hollywood stars.
James Garner,
which took the lead role, as we see him here on the poster.
Yeah, and because it was such a challenging film to shoot, it also received 3 Academy Awards for various technical categories. In a sense, it was a great success, and I only saw the trailer. Trailer looks good, very engaging. So I guess it's probably technically was very difficult to capture the races, and I'm looking forward to watching it.
Yep. And we have to keep in mind that at that time, 1960s, the cameras had not been small as we practically today. I think each Formula One cars had several little cameras everywhere. But at that time, you had to put a movie camera at the back of the car or at the front of a car. So it was quite challenging.
Well, I think at the moment, almost everything is CGI. And races are shot digitally. And I think one of the last famous films where races or car driving in any case was shot the old-fashioned way is, of course, Death Proof by Tarantino, where you could see how difficult it was, because you could see the real stuntman driving with a person that is kind of driving on top of the car in front of the driver, so you can't really see anything in this case. You just can see the person that is in front of you. So definitely that was very challenging, and it is a rare it is a rare scene now when these types of things are shot live, shot, you know, in old-fashioned way. Yeah. So normally it's all sort of, you have a green screen and you have a digital, digital means 3D models and, you know, looks, it all doesn't look real anymore. But back in the day, they shot everything. Well, the stunts were real stunts. They were not 3D digital prints of people and models of how things could, you know, break and explode or whatever.
Yeah, I remember there are some documentaries about the making of the famous Le Mans movie, where you see the cars with the movie cameras and how they really did it.
Yeah, so it wasn't easy, definitely. So that's, so that makes it even more sort of desirable to watch, pretty much probably like, you know, the old sort of 70s films about racing or motorsport or generally driving and cool cars like Vanishing Point and those types of things. Okay, so again, one of the rare pictures of Lorenzo Bandini, a close shot of him inside the car, but at least it's a portrait. And with that, we're going to his famous quotes.
Exactly. So we didn't found a lot, and so just these three. I think it's all a destiny in life. It's not just someone who runs in a car. If one has to die at some point, if it's destiny that has to die that day, he dies whether he goes running in a car or does not running in a car. So similar to Alberto Ascari, for example, he believed in his destiny. And if you compare it, let's say, to what we discussed, about Monaco, quite interesting to see. The second quote, fear never settles, understandable as a driver. I mean, if you would lose your fear, you lose the respect to the car and to the situation. And I think really it would be very dangerous if the fear would settle, because it means automatically that you lose respect to the situation, and that you do admit to higher risks than you really should do.
Yeah, I mean, I was just going to say to this, to comment on that, you know, when we saw sort of big, really big accidents and big risk taking, it was very often from drivers who thought that nothing could happen to them while they are in the car. And also it kind of reminds me I was just watching with my son, we watch a lot of videos about astronauts. And there was a really cool series that they shot. I think it was maybe in the 2018, 2019. It was 1 year in space, it's called. And it kind of follows astronauts around the space station throughout the year. So there are several episodes. And they interviewed these astronauts about the outer space. And they said, well, when you go into outer space, and generally, are you scared? Like, are you afraid that something could go wrong? And all of them said, yes, of course. And it's a good thing to be afraid, because when you stop being afraid, that's when stuff happens. Yeah. So and it's kind of like that outer space for Formula One as well, because the speeds are high and you have to be very careful. And you know, if you lose your concentration for 1 second, it can have deadly consequences, not only for you, but for other people around you. And in that sense, yeah, it's a healthy thing to be, you know, to be aware of the situation, not necessarily to be afraid. But I think what he means is that, you know, you should always understand that this is risky, right? So you should always have the understanding that it is a risky and uncertain environment where you operate.
Yeah. And the last quote we found, you only look at the deaths that happen in motor racing Then we abolished the planes, we abolished the cars, we abolished everyone. We are closed in the house, so we are sure that we do not die and we return as once with the donkey. The donkey and the horses, and so it's sure that we are less dead. So here he underlined the importance of taking risk to progress in life, but I think also in society. And this is something related to the idea that a lot of important developments, which we found later in our streetcars, came first from the racetrack.
So well, I mean, it just, you know, I think it just speaks to this fact that, you know, if you are afraid of taking risk, you should just be at home, but then you do not develop. You will always be where you are. And, you know, to that, I only can add the following that, you know, we see a lot, even in the current situation, right, with COVID, that most policies are about scaring people. They just say, like, if you don't do that, you're going to die horribly or something like this. But no one explains to you what is the probability of dying in different situations if you do ABCD and how, you know, how exactly risky something is. And in that sense, I think, you know, if we maybe spend more time explaining the risk to people mm-hmm. rather than just trying to kind of make them afraid, we would have been a lot better off. And I think as a Formula One driver, like to me, when, you know, when we interviewed in my lab, we interviewed some drivers, competitive drivers. So we didn't interview Formula One, obviously, because they are celebrities and hard to get to. But generally, we interviewed competitive drivers a lot. And most of them do not consider this to be a, you know, high risk occupation. They just say, well, it's my job, you know, it's my job to drive. So I need to be, of course, aware of the situation and understand who is around me and what is the situation like and what decision I need to take. So the concentration is extremely important, but it's necessary to take risk. Otherwise, you know, you will not you will not proceed, you will not develop, and you will not develop as a driver, and you will not win, which is important.
Exactly, and this is not only risking your life or your health, I mean, also it could be the risk to change your job, for example, or you change your position, you're not sure, am I good in this new job? Or a position, but I mean, if you never try, you never know, and you cannot develop, of course.
Yeah, so we've discussed quite a lot about Lorenzo Bandini in general. In terms of, we haven't actually talked much about character. And this is practically due to sort of general lack of information about him. But you can kind of tell from the biography that we just discussed during this episode that he was definitely a very strong personality because he, like I explained at the beginning, had to provide for his family from a very young age. He took opportunities when they came, and he was, of course, he seemed to be very, very nice, weighted, calm person that at the same time was loved by a great number of people. And considering that he was loved by so many people, you know, he was really this role model for many sort of Italian Italian fans, and also this the fact that he had this really great and weighted approach to racing. He also was very efficient in endurance races. So, and this is something that he shared with other drivers with, I guess, similar approach, like, for example, Phil Hill, right? We discussed Phil Hill. So, but of course, like when we discussed Phil Hill, we were talking about his professionalism, right? So he's like this expert driver, professional driver. I mean, here we see basically a person who, in a sense, was probably didn't show that much passion, but at the same time did really put his heart into this work, and that was felt obviously by the fan base. So in that sense, I think that's to me that's kind of the summary of the character.
Exactly.
And if you agree.
I agree. And if you see the few information we have, he seemed to be a very down-to-earth person. He entered in this workshop, had a long relation with the owner. He married quite early. He lived quite near Ferrari in the Emilia Romagna. And so even if he had many fans, even if he drove for the country's most famous race team, that this changed his character. He not became the big playboy being in high society, but really seemed to be somebody near to the normal people around him. I think this was also one of the reasons why he was so much beloved.
That's right. So, notable wins. Well, of course, we have to mention Austria, and we have to mention, we have to probably go with non-Formula One performance as well. Yes. And, Le Mans and other races that we've discussed in this episode, in Formula One, definitely Austria that stands out. Notable accidents, well, we have to go with his death effectively in 1967. Yeah. And in terms of racing strategy, this very weighted approach to risk and trying to anticipate things is something I think that distinguished him from the rest, and made him especially efficient in endurance racing, because probably this is, as we saw, this is probably not the best strategy for Formula One racing, where, it seems like people who are more passionate do better, but at the same time made him extremely good at races like Le Mans and other long distance, long time endurance motor racing.
Yeah, I agreed with you. And he was a calm player, and as you described, he was also a very good team player. And then we have our last point, legacy. He was this beloved person, so let's say no surprise that they founded a trophy named after him, and it's an annual award which goes to a driver or to a team, not only related to the success, but also how they achieved the success. So being, a good, positive sportsman, an ambassador for motorsports, for example. Again, if you are on YouTube, you see here a photo of the 2018 winner, Valtteri Bottas. And also, you can see quite nicely here the trophy, which is a ceramic replica of his Ferrari 312. So quite, nice trophy, a little bit different than the normal trophies which you normally get.
Yeah, I just also wanted to say about the, this overwhelming love and support that he enjoyed. I think, of course, it is partly due to the talent, but also I think one of the things that stands out, and again, from the things that I read about him, is that, as we discussed, he was like a child of war, and he came from a very simple background. And he was a little bit like, the guy next door, And when people looked at him, they thought, okay, you know, like, yeah, we've had all these iconic figures in the sport before who probably had, generations of their family in racing and all that, or had gentleman drivers, or had, really rich guys. But I mean, this was a guy who was really kind of coming from, he was very simple. He was just like everybody else, right? Yeah. He was just like everybody else, and at the same time, he was unique. And that kind of was very close to the psychology of many people who thought, okay, well, if this guy can do it, I can do it as well, right? So he's one of us, in a sense. So, and that kind of added to this massive popularity in Italy, and the feeling that people had that he was basically just like any other guy, right? And that made him very, very approachable and very, very sort of loved by the public.
Exactly, he was like everybody else, and thanks to his character, he forgot that he's like everybody else. So. The fans never lost the close contact. And also due to this, they named this trophy for him, which is a quite interesting one and quite important in the motorsport, in the world of motorsports. Here, a panel of 12 judges composed of former motor racing journalists and also Formula One team members determines the recipient of the award. And there's an annual ceremony in his hometown, Brescella, in Emilia-Romagna, where they give the trophy to one of the drivers or team principals or the team itself. In the last years, this event also was organized juntos con the with the Minardi days. I think Minardi is another very beloved name in Italy, this little Formula One team. And we will come to this, I'm sure, in some later episode where we speak about the 1990s.
Yeah, I mean, it would be cool to know the criteria, how exactly they select the winner, because obviously, I mean, this is not based on performance. So if you just won the season, it doesn't actually count. But it is in a sense based on the opinion of experts. And so in a sense, it's expertise prize. I'm sure there is a set of criteria that they apply. So it would be actually cool to know how exactly, you know, what exactly they are considering as important contribution. I guess to as many competitions, it is a rather subjective selection. But it is great to have, something else apart from the usual, you know, whatever this athlete of the year awards and other things that are quite, I think, sometimes quite boring, like whoever, whoever achieved a win gets the prize. So in this case, it's a little bit more intriguing, and you can get people who are, who are good with team spirit, or who are just good in consistency, or, in some other aspect of motorsport. And they are those sort of unsung heroes of the sport who get this award. Yeah, in a sense, in many ways, that continues the legacy, right, of Lorenzo Bandini.
I think interesting, it seems that they try to keep it near to the people, so it's not in a closed ceremony hall. But here we see, for example, in the photo, we see Bottas in the center of this little Italian city. You see the Formula One fans who can be near to their drivers, so I think it keeps up somehow his spirit. And important also for the prize, you can only receive it once, so you cannot win it twice. So we cannot have Lewis Hamilton winning it seven times in a row or whatever.
Yes, so which also makes it interesting. And, yeah, quite a long list of people here with the trophy. And yeah.
Exactly, and maybe a little bit focus with Italians. We had the first winner was Ivan Capelli in 1902. Then we had David Coulthard, Jacques Villeneuve. We have Luca Cordero di Montesimolo, Giancarlo Fisichella, Alexander Wurz, Jano Trulli, Jensen Button, Juan Pablo Montoya, Michael Schumacher, Kimi Räikkönen, Fernando Alonso, Mark Webber, Felipe Massa, Robert Kubica, Sebastian Vettel, Lewis Hamilton, Nico Rosberg, Bruno Senna, Piero Ferrari, Daniele Ricciardo. Then in 2015, the first time we have a team, it went to the Mercedes F1 team. 2016, it went to Max Verstappen, then Scuderia Ferrari, Valtteri Bottas as seen, and the latest winner was the Alfa Romeo pilot driver Antonio Giovinazzi.
Yeah, that's right. So I wonder about the 2020. So, yeah.
It's tricky because you have to find someone or some team, but also somebody who not received it before.
Yes, and now we are also in the Corona situation. So I'm just wondering how exactly they handled this or will handle it this year. So I don't know whether it was already awarded this year or not, but it would be interesting to see. I guess they awarded probably at the beginning of next year, right? After the year end.
Yeah, or also you see in the beginning, it's not automatically an annual reward. In the beginning, they did it the first time in 1992, and then they waited 3 years for whatever reason to give it to David Coulthard. So maybe they just skip it and say 2020. Nobody. Who knows?
Yeah. Interesting. Well, they consistently have given it out every year now, so maybe we will see someone. It's interesting.
Yeah. I assume so, but let's see. Okay, that's all we've prepared for Lorenzo Bandini.
Yeah, so quite a memorable character. Definitely memorable in to many Italian fans, and yeah, really, this guy next door. I mean, for some reason, we didn't have didn't quite discuss the legacy, but yeah, I guess he was this guy next door who made it in the sport, in yep. Formula One sport. So on that happy note and the message that anybody can make it with enough effort and hard
not
work.
Only New York.
Yeah, exactly. So with enough effort and hard work. So we leave you with this thought and we will see you next time. And as usual, you can find us on various platforms as a podcast and on YouTube as a main series. So video series and so we hope to see you next time and have a nice day wherever you are.
Have a nice day, nice morning, nice afternoon, evening, whenever you see or listen to us.